Let's start lesson 1, The Pandora's Box. Little Candy Jane was a very curious little girl of 11. She always got into scraps and could not stay out of trouble. She loved to ask questions and asked them so often that everyone got tired of her. Candy Jane had an old neighbor who was a gardener, but everyone called him Professor Bogle because he loved to read. He was the only person who could answer all of Candy Jane's questions. One day, Candy Jane's father said to her, "Candy Jane, you are a Pandora's box. I never know what you are going to do next." Curious Candy Jane looked up at her father and said, "But father, I am neither Pandora nor a box." Her father wrote. Confused, Candy Jane ran out to see Professor Bogle, who was reading in the garden. "Professor Bogle, Professor Bogle, tell me, who is a Pandora's box?" "My father called me a Pandora's box." The professor looked at Candy Jane and smiled. "Child, it is not who, but what. Come and sit while I tell you a story. Many centuries ago, Greeks believed in gods who were like men but were strong. They could change themselves into anything. Mortal men, animals, plants, or monsters," said Professor Bogle. "Their greatest god was Zeus. He was very angry with mortals because they used fire. Fire was stolen from Zeus by another god called Prometheus. Zeus ordered the creation of the first woman from clay. Her name was Pandora, and she was sent to the earth." Candy Jane eagerly looked at the professor. Pandora was given a box. She was told never to open it. Now, Pandora was given many good qualities along with curiosity. In fact, she was as curious as you are. She was so inquisitive about the box that she opened it. Out of the box came all the evil in the world. It is said that at the bottom of the box only hope remains. So, Pandora's box means to invite trouble. Candy Jane, finished Professor Bogle. "So, why did my father call me a Pandora's box?" asked Candy Jane. "Well, see here, little girl. You are always asking questions. You are also very curious about things, and this gets you into all kinds of trouble. Candy Jane, you can get into trouble even when you are eating. So, your parents and everyone else never know what is going to happen next. That is why your father called you a Pandora's box," said Professor Bogle. "Now I understand. Are there more stories like these? Tell me some more, please, Professor," begged Candy Jane. "I will tell you one more, and others you will have to find on your own," said the professor. "Long ago, Midas was a king of Thessalonica. He asked one companion of Dionysus, a god, to grant him the gift of turning whatever he touched into gold. Midas was granted his wish. So, everything that King Midas touched turned into gold. He could not even eat food. Then, one day his daughter touched him and he was gloomy. Guess what happened? She turned into gold," said Candy Jane to the smiling professor. "Now, a person who is always lucky is said to have the Midas touch," explained Professor Bogle. "But Professor, what happened to the daughter?" asked Candy Jane. "After Midas' daughter was turned into gold, he hated the power that he had asked for. He prayed to Dionysus, who told Midas to wash himself in river Pactolus. When King Midas did so, his power washed away and flowed into the river. And everything that Midas had turned into gold took its old form," finished the professor. Suddenly, Candy Jane started clapping and laughing. "What is so funny, little one?" quizzed Professor Bogle. "Oh, Professor, so the story of King Midas also tells us that it is bad to want more things than we really need. These old stories are so useful for our everyday situations," exclaimed Candy Jane. Smiling, Professor Bogle replied, "Yes, they are. Myths are stories about the past. Sometimes they tell stories of the heroes of culture, and sometimes they are about imaginary people or creatures who live, and also the way they live. Every culture has its own mythology." "That is so wonderful. I want to know more," said the excited Candy Jane. "Candy Jane, you go to the library and find out what Achilles' heel, Herculean effort, and hot as Hades mean." Candy Jane found Greek mythology so interesting that she went to the library to find the answers. Let's start lesson 2. Vanity is a horrid vice. Mr. Raven was perched upon a limb, and Reynard the fox looked up at him. For the raven held in his great big beak a morsel the fox would go far to see. Said the fox in admiring tones, "My word, Sir Raven, you are a handsome bird. Such feathers, if you would only sing, the birds of these woods would call you king." The raven, who did not see the joke, forget that his voice was just a crow. He opened his beak in his foolish pride and fell down the morsel the fox had spied. "Ha ha," said the fox, "and now you see, you should not listen to flattery. Vanity, sir, is a horrid vice. I am sure the lesson is worth the price." Let's start lesson 3, A Sailor and His Pet. Old sailor Johnny Jay loved the sea. From the year he turned 12, he started sailing. Since then, it has been 66 years. He has sailed across the world. He has seen many countries, but the sea was his home. He did not like to live on the land for a long period of time. He had a small cabin on an island of Guiana, where he chose to stay instead with his family, which lived on a nearby island. Johnny Jay has had only one constant friend over the years. Crazy Coot, as he was known, spoke like a man but with a very odd shrieking tone. Crazy Coot and Johnny Jay both loved the sea and, like all sailors, enjoyed their own company. Meeting people always made them cranky with people. But what made Crazy Coot really special was that he was a macaw, a kind of South American parrot. His plumage and tail feathers were scarlet in color, the rump of light blue and the upper wings of yellow. Macaws are very intelligent and can be taught to speak. Crazy Coot had a bad temper, and when irritated, he would shout almost like humans. He loved watching old movies with Johnny Jay and could imitate sounds of gunfire. He could also speak some dialogues from some movies. He loved to whistle. Whenever he saw a girl or a woman, he would whistle loudly and pretend to faint. He also threw his favorite food, sunflower seeds, throughout Johnny Jay's house and loved to hide behind things. Johnny Jay and Crazy Coot were a well-matched pair, stubborn and solitary. Johnny Jay's older sister, Missy May, was not fond of macaw. She would visit them when Johnny Jay and Crazy Coot were staying in their home on the island of Guiana. Whenever Missy May was around, Crazy Coot, he would screech at her. Then he would make sound of police siren and gunshots and laugh aloud. Missy May, as you can imagine, was not very happy with Crazy Coot. One afternoon, Missy May came to visit Johnny Jay. When she did not find her brother in the house, she decided to sleep in the parlor for some time. She ignored Crazy Coot. When he did not get the attention that he wanted, Crazy Coot started muttering and then hid behind some books. Then a thief climbed in from the window of the parlor. He started putting things in his bag quietly because he did not want to wake up Missy May. But the thief did not know about Crazy Coot, who was hiding behind the books. Out of nowhere, someone shouted, "You thief, you kill me. Leave me alone. I call police. You go to jail. You thief, are you trying to kill me? Leave me alone. I will call the police. You will go to jail." It was followed by the sounds of police sirens and gunshots. Suddenly, terrified, the thief stood as if he had turned into stone. The thief jumped to escape, and at the same time, the sister shot up from the chair. Surprised, the thief tripped and struck his head on the table. He fainted. Missy May then called the police, who arrested the thief. Feeling ecstatic at being saved, Missy May went to Crazy Coot to pet him. Crazy Coot said, "You thief, you kill me. Leave me alone. I call police. You go to jail. Ha ha ha." The police froze when they heard Crazy Coot and then burst out laughing. They understood how Missy May was able to escape unhurt. Let's start lesson 4, Gift of Talking to Birds. A lad named Kong Hyeo Chiang, who lived with his parents in the mountains, understood the language of birds. One evening, as he was studying, a flock of birds sat on a tree before his window and sang, "Kong Hyeo Chiang, on the southern plain, a sheep awaits you by a heap of stones. A fine fat wether that the dogs have slain, you eat the flesh and we will pick the bones." Kong Hyeo Chiang went and brought the sheep home and cooked it for dinner. The next morning, a shepherd came and said that one of his sheep was missing. He had found blood on the meadow, had followed the trail, and it had brought him to that house. Kong Hyeo Chiang said that he had brought in the sheep which was killed by the dog. The birds had told him about it. Nobody believed him, as they thought he made up the story. He was taken to the prison. While he was awaiting his trial before the magistrate, a bird flying eastward, perched on the wall, saw him and piped. Foes approached the western border, banners, bows and spears in order, while the gate lacks watch or warder. Kong Hyeo Chiang urged his jailer to inform the magistrate of the danger of invasion through the unprotected western pass. The jailer did not believe in Kong Hyeo Chiang's ability to speak to the bird and was also afraid of the magistrate. So he decided to test the young boy first. He took some rice, soaked a part of it in sweetened water and a part in salt water. He then spread the whole on the roof of a shed. He brought Kong Hyeo Chiang and asked him if he knew why so many birds were chirping overhead. Kong Hyeo Chiang at once replied that those on the roof were hailing those that were flying past and saying, "Call a halt, call a halt. Here is a rice fresh and white. Half is sweet, half is salt. Stop a bit, take a bite." The jailer was convinced that the prisoner understood the speech of birds and therefore hurried away to warn the magistrate. He told the magistrate of the warning and the test. The magistrate sent a swift courier to notify the military officers, and a scout was sent out to the west. Kong Hyeo Chiang's words were confirmed and troops were dispatched to strengthen. The garrison at the pass. The invaders were stopped just in time. The great service rendered to the country by Kong Hyeo Chiang was acknowledged by his sovereign. He was invited to study with the princes and eventually raised to a high rank among the nobles of the empire. Let's start lesson 5, 3 cheers for Gumdi Cat. I have a Gumdi Cat in mind. Her name is Juniani Dot. Her coat is of the tabby kind with tiger stripes and leopard spots. All day she sits upon the stair or on the steps or on the mat. She sits and sits and sits and sits, and that's what makes a Gumdi Cat. But when the day's hustle and bustle is done, then the Gumdi Cat's work is but hardly begun. And when all the family is in bed and asleep, she tucks up her skirts to the basement to creep. She's deeply concerned with the ways of the mice, their behaviors not good and their manners not nice. So when she has got them lined up on the matting, she teaches them music, crouching and tatting. I have a Gumdi Cat in mind. Her name is Juniani Dots. Her equal would be hard to find. She likes the warm and sunny spots. All day she sits beside the earth or on the bed or on my hat. She sits and sits and sits and sits, and that's what makes a Gumdi Cat. But when the day's hustle and bustle is done, then the Gumdi Cat's work is but hardly begun. As she finds that the mice will not ever keep quiet, she is sure it is due to irregular diet. And believing that nothing is done without trying, she sets right to work with her baking and frying. She makes them a mousse cake of bread and dried beans and a beautiful fry of lean bacon and cheese. So for old Gumdi Cat, let us now give 3 cheers. On whom well-ordered households depend, it appears.